Welcome to Connie Martinson Talks Books. I got a terrific novel that we have been reading, and I'm going to be talking to the author, Seth Greenland. The book is called The Angry Buddhist, but it's Three Brothers Who, and the book is published by Europa Press. Welcome, Seth.
Thank you for having me.
I'm delighted. Listen, usually you hear Three Girls Who. This is Three Brothers Who. Totally different, forced to sort of help bring up each other.
Mm-hmm.
And the eldest, who is Randall, says, listen, I'm going to law school. And he's sort of caught in a bind, and he puts it on the younger brother, Dale. And Jimmy, who is the middle brother, has sort of not been involved that much with the three of them since the father died. And that, my dear, as I say, made all the difference in the world. Tell our friends a little bit more about the book and the fact it has an interesting open that it sort of is a shock. Two women off on a romantic weekend in Mexico, and one you know is married, the other one isn't. And she says, listen, the younger one's a sporty little kid, let's go have tattoos done the same, and they have it done on their left buttock, and we don't know who, what, but it does play back.
Yes, that's a depth charge that detonates deeper into the book that I set up at the very beginning. But to answer your question about the three brothers, it's the Duke brothers, Randall, who is the oldest, who's a congressman, Jimmy, who's the middle brother, who's a former policeman, and Dale, who's the youngest brother, who is a career criminal. It's set in Palm Springs. Randall is running for re-election. The book takes place in the 9 days around the election, and what happens broadly is something goes spectacularly wrong. It involves all three brothers and threatens to destroy their lives.
And along with that, there is, Randall is, let's say he is, he's a kingmaker and he's made a king.
Mm-hmm.
So that when he wants to get his brother Dale out of jail, he can do it.
Mm-hmm.
And he also is running against a woman named Mary Swain, who, as someone in the book says, she is the sort that every guy who drinks two bottles of beer says, I wish I had her.
Well, yeah, in the book I describe, one of the characters says it's hard running against a woman who Joe Sixpack wants to leave his wife for.
Yeah.
And she's that genus of American political life right now, a very, very physically attractive, hardcore conservative female that people might recognize from real life or not, depending upon how much they watch TV or read the papers.
Yes, married to a very rich man,
mm-hmm.
whom she had been the stewardess or the drink person mm-hmm. on his private plane.
Exactly.
While he was still married.
She was the stewardess on his Gulfstream 6, and he was a guy who got rich in the mortgage, the subprime mortgage explosion that occurred earlier this decade, and she married this fellow and decided she wanted a political career, which he is bankrolling.
Yeah, after having four kids.
Four photogenic kids.
Yes. Yeah. So she had put her so-called money in the bank
mm-hmm.
with the kids, and now she could do her own number.
She would like to go to Washington and
yes.
represent this very, very conservative interests.
Very conservative. Now, Randall is the sort who will go along with most anything,
mm-hmm.
but he doesn't want to lose this election.
Yeah, he does not have a very firm moral center. What he's really about is retaining power,
yeah.
and he will do anything to retain power, and it surprises him how much he'll do, but he rises to the occasion and does his worst.
All right, tell me about his second in command, the guy who does the maneuvering.
His second in command is a guy called Maxon Bray, who is Randall's chief aide. He's his political brain. He's something of a quasi Karl Rove figure.
Yeah.
He is a I think he's secretly in love with Randall and will literally do anything for him, as he does in the course of the book.
You know, I said to you earlier, there's a lot of it that is sort of Shakespearean. Mm-hmm. Like, he is a Iago.
Mm-hmm.
That there's a lot of, and you have done enough background story for me to be able to read it and figure it out.
Mm-hmm. Well, the characters all have a degree of psychological depth, I think, that explains some of the terrible things they do, and in some cases, the not-so-terrible things they do. But what I tried to do in this book, although there's violence and mm-hmm. murders occur and that kind of thing, I tried to lend it a psychological depth so it's not a genre book, really.
When you were writing it, because everybody's life sort of connects in this book, were you aware of it? I mean, is that part of your plot?
Yeah, I had a broad stroke plot worked out when I began, and I didn't know everything that would be happening. It took on something of a life of its own as I went along, but I had vague signposts that I wanted to hit in terms of the storytelling. And the complexity of the plot, I worked out as I went along, actually. Yeah. It became much more complex than what I had originally envisioned.
And the role of dogs. I mean, again, Nadine Never, mm-hmm. which is a great name.
Thank you.
Turns out to be, had been a tennis pro.
Mm-hmm.
She has gone off. She now is working in a tanning salon. And she meets Harding, the police chief.
Mm-hmm.
He is mad for her. I wouldn't say he's madly in love, he's just mad for her. And she realizes what all he's saying, we'll get married, we'll do that. No way is he leaving his wife. And she's too also an interesting, his wife.
Well, his wife is a woman who is a martial arts expert. She runs a dojo in 29 Palms. We should say the book is set in the Mojave Desert, in that arc that descends down from 29 Palms down to Palm Springs and then southeast to the Salton Sea. But Vonda Jean Marvin is her name, and as I said, she runs a dojo, and she's a very smart businessman, a very, very tough woman who hard worries if she suspects that he is cheating on her, could shoot him in his sleep.
But even within that sort of junction, Jimmy he was kicked out of the police force mm-hmm. by Hard.
Mm-hmm.
Why? Because he wouldn't kill a dog.
Yeah, a dog, a police dog goes rogue when they're making a bust and tears up a criminal. And for political reasons, Hard needs to have the dog put down and tells Jimmy to do this. And of course, Jimmy objects because he loves the dog.
Yeah.
And of course, all hell breaks loose as a result of that.
And then the coin turns around because Nadine sees about killing Harden's dog, whom he loves more than his wife, more than anything.
Well, right, not to give too much away, but Nadine believed Hard's lies that he would leave his wife and run off with her. And she's got a bit of a problem with drugs and alcohol and visits him one night and poisons his dog. And his dog is really the one being in the world with whom he really connects, because he doesn't really connect with people. So this, of course, sends him into a tailspin with dire results.
So now we know that Nadine is interspersed with Randall's wife, Kendra, who suddenly feels she's being blackmailed, even if she isn't, and with Harden, who supports Mary Swain. So you've set it up that it's almost a tennis match.
Yeah, well, more than a tennis match. If it were to be a tennis match, I would say it was a tennis match being played in three dimensions, really, because there are more than two people hitting the particular ball that we're talking about in the storytelling. There's a lot of moving parts. There are a lot of plates that are spinning in the story. And I think what I tried to do was make everything come together in a satisfying way.
Yeah, including our friend Dale. You said he was a career
criminal. Yes,
I've never heard that expression before.
Well, it's somebody who makes a career out of crime.
Right.
He can't stay out of jail. He's not he's not a horrible guy. He's not a killer. He just is a hard luck individual who really didn't have many breaks and made one very bad decision, and everything sprung from that when
and
he was
has
younger.
Has made him, of course, he's a paralyzed.
Yeah, yeah. He was crippled in a motorcycle accident.
So when they are saying, how do we get rid of this woman, they turn to Dale and say, who do you know who for money will take care of our problem?
Well, that isn't exactly what happens. What happens in the book is Dale overhears a conversation and decides he can help. He wants to do his brother a favor, so he arranges for something to happen that will take care of this person. Not to kill her, but to take her out of the picture for a little while.
But as you have written it, it is beautifully done by how they involve her and then what does happen.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Which brings, at the end, all of the people get their uppance.